let me know when you want to start. Tracy? Kandinsky thing.
I want to welcome Michelle Merrim today, and Michelle is going to be speaking about Wassily Kandinsky. Am I pronouncing that right?
If anybody's Russian, I would. Can you hear me, by the way?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
If anybody's Russian out there, I would appreciate the correct pronunciation. But somebody, a Russian once told me it was Wassily Kandinsky.
Oh, okay.
All so right. I don't know. I don't know how good my Russian pronunciation is. But.
And following the presentation, we're going to do an art project. So Michelle is asking that everyone has white paper, and we'll give you a few minutes afterwards if you don't.
It's a very simple art project.
White paper, markers, colored pencils, pens, rulers, a cup, or glasses.
Yeah.
So let's
very
get simple. Started. I'm very excited. Thank you for doing
yeah,
that, Michelle.
Yeah, sure. I'm excited too. So first I want to say this, because last time I gave this presentation, I forgot, I wore this, but I forgot to show it. This is a tie. Can you see me? Oh, actually, you probably can't, can you? Can you see me? Do you have a speaker thing
yes,
up?
Yes, we can see you.
We can see you, Michelle.
Up at the top, we can see you.
Got it. So this is a gift my husband got, and it's a tie a la Kandinsky. So I wore it, and I just want you to know that's what it is. I don't normally wear ties. So Wassily Kandinsky was born in the middle of the 19th century in Moscow. And what I want you to think about today, what we're going to be taught, he's considered one of the fathers of abstraction. Okay, so Mondrian we did last time, and he was in Western Europe. They kind of overlapped, although their work was very independent. They overlapped in terms of time period, but they both kind of made this road through to abstraction. And different, they end up in different places, but they're both different kinds of abstraction. So the things I want to think, I want you to think about today, the words are color and line and form. Composition, how things are put together. Music. Music is very important in this to this artist. Emotion and spirituality. And I want you to think about all those kinds of things. You don't have to think about them all at the same time, but they'll all come into our discussion. The first piece I want to show you is a video that was made that kind of explains, oh, it just started pouring here, that explains abstraction and how we got to abstraction and kind of what it's all about. So, if I have the right one, nope, that's not the right one, this is the right one. Okay, so we're gonna start here. Thank you.
Art. Where should we begin? Take a guess at how long humans have been creating art. Can you believe that this cave painting was created nearly 40,000 years ago? Humans have been painting before they could even do math, read, or write. Creating art was and still is one of the strongest human impulses. But now let's move a bit closer to today and find out what was happening. Just 100 years ago, one of the most intensely creative periods of our time began. Now keep in mind that artists had moved beyond cave paintings by this point. They sculpted and painted with extremely realistic detail. Take a look at Michelangelo's David and Da Vinci's Mona Lisa. But many artists during the early 1900s wanted to do something different. They didn't want to just paint or sculpt perfectly realistic images. They wanted to express how they felt, and they wanted us to feel the emotions they were trying to express. One group of artists, the Blue Writers, came together in Germany to create a new standard in art. Art was to come from within the artist, rather than from the external world. The Blue Writers were part of an art movement called German Expressionism. These Blue Writers rebelled against the way art was normally created. They expressed feelings and abstract ideas, paving the way for abstract art. But before we talk more about these Blue Writers, let's pause for a minute to understand what we really mean when we say abstract art. Something that's abstract refers to an idea or feeling rather than a concrete object, like a rock or a tree. For example, we feel love, but we can't really draw a realistic image of love. We have, however, learned a symbol for love, the shape of a heart. But keep in mind, someone first drew this symbol, and then they assigned the meaning for the symbol. It's just been so used that now, when we draw the abstract idea of love, we draw a heart. We might even paint it red for romance, or yellow for friendship, to further express how we feel.
So I just thought that was a nice picture, kind of taking us through. And I also want to mention to you what was happening in the middle of the 19th century in terms of technology and art was photography. So I think that had a big impact on the fact that before things were very, painting and sculpture and so on, were very realistic. But as we move on, now we have photographs and we can show things through photography. So it's interesting to me that at that point, right at that point, is when we start doing other things like impressionism and moving on from there, even pre-impressionism. So I just wanted to mention that because obviously what's going on in the world has a lot to do with how things move forward in all kinds of fields, including art. So Kandinsky was a very unusual guy. He was at a very early age, he had a real sensitivity toward colors and sounds and the stimuli of sounds and words and colors and what he saw. His family encouraged art and he took piano lessons, he took cello lessons. They gave him private drawing lessons. So he had an early exposure to the arts. But when he went on after high school, he attended the University of Moscow to study law, economics, and ethnography. So he left his art behind. And he went on and he studied and he finished and he became a lecturer at the University of Moscow in law and economics. Huh. So he has, and we'll do a couple of these through this talk, a couple of epiphanies in his life. One of those is when he's 30 and he sees an incredible, or what to him is an incredible exhibition that comes to Moscow. And it's Monet. Monet is one of the first impressionists. He's really the father of impressionism. And again, we are not talking about abstraction. We can tell what these are. These are his famous haystacks. And his famous haystacks are at different times of day on the right-hand side there. But he is floored by this. He sees painting in a whole new light. And if you excuse the pun, because Monet used a lot of light senses in his paintings, and that was a big part of it. And I wanted to read you a quote of his. He's written a lot, by the way, Kandinsky, so we know a lot of his what happened in his life. And he grew infatuated with these haystacks. He said, I saw... I couldn't recognize it as a haystack. It was painful to me. I considered that the painter had no right to paint so indistinctly, and I felt that the object of the painting was missing. And again, he's comparing it to very realistic paintings. And I noticed with surprise and confusion that the picture not only gripped me, but impressed itself ineradicably on my memory. Painting took on a fairy tale power and splendor. So he sees this. This is very soon afterwards, he goes to a concert, and it's an opera, a Wagner opera, and he hears this music, which has another. And as I said, he's very into music. So I'm just going to play this for a little while. Normally, I would speak while that music is in the background, but I'm told that that's not a good thing to do in this venue. So I stopped the music. But he was absolutely floored by this music. And he says, and it was soon after he saw Monet exhibit. And he wrote that during the opera, he says, I saw all my colors in spirit before my eyes. Wild, almost crazy lines were sketched in front of me. And it became clear to me that art in general was much more powerful than I had thought. And that on the other hand, painting was capable of developing powers akin to those of music. Now, one thing to mention here is that we think that based on a lot of his writing, that he experienced this condition called synesthesia, which is a diagnosed condition today. It's very rare, but we think he had it. And basically what that is when some people diagnosed with it say that they can hear colors or taste sounds, that some of their senses are kind of cross-wired a little bit. And in his, or a lot, and in Kandinsky's case, he seemed to, when he saw colors, he heard sounds. And when he heard sounds, he saw certain colors. And that was a big part of his experience with art. And so music keeps coming into his art, and color is very important. So at this point, as I say, he was still teaching in Moscow. He's 30, but he decides to give that up. And he goes and he enters the Munich Academy of Arts in Germany, where a lot is going on. Again, he's 30, and he just suddenly gives it up. He's there for a few years learning, but actually it's kind of interesting because he it's for him more traditional than he wants. And in fact, some of the paintings there, and I'll show you one he did while he was there, He was told he used too much color, that it was too bright. But he did move there. He stayed at the academy for a few years, and he actually broke off with a few other students at one point after a few years, they started their own school called the Phalanx, P-H-A-L-A-N-X, and they started teaching their own art, but then they were also doing some of their own work at the same time. So this is one of his very famous paintings, and I'm kind of going to take you through some of his breakthrough paintings at this point. This is actually called Blue Rider, he called it, and it was before the Blue Rider movement that we heard at the beginning was established. But here we have, take a look. By the way, with some of the things I'm going to show you, I'm just going to show it and be quiet for a few seconds so you have a chance to look at it without having my voice pounding over at you. So here we can see that he really, it's a link to the Impressionists, right? He's got those big brush strokes. It's not, you know, clear lines and very realistic. We can see the light, which is very important. And the figure on horseback. He does do a lot of figures on horses, by the way. Some people have interpreted it as, you know, riding away from convention. I don't know if that's a little much, but you'll also see that he really likes the color blue through his things. He finds it a very spiritual kind of color. By the way, I should say, and Sean, I think I should have said at the beginning, if anybody has any comments, please unmute yourself and feel free. Okay, any comments on this? Okay, next. Blue Mountain. Here's another. And if you know the Fauves, which was actually a movement in France, which sometimes you'll see a woman with a green face. They have different colors that don't match reality. That's what this one seems to remind people of. The mountain is blue. Again, we have the people on horses. And again, it's not realistic, right? Red and yellow trees on the sides. And again, we have that blue that Kandinsky interpreted as very symbolic of spirit, great spiritual color. I'm still here, I'm just letting you look.
This is beautiful. This one is just stunning.
So again, we're moving on now. Look at the snow. It gives a, you know, it's snow, right? But I don't know, we didn't have much snow this winter, but sometimes when you're out in the snow and you see, it's not just white, it's the way the sun kind of gives an impression off of the white. And I can think of things in the 20th century where actually illustrators and so on have presented snow this way as well. And those thin black trunks, he often uses those as landscapes, that line. So the coloring is pretty bright. And again, it conveys different light effects. So now we're on to a new epiphany, another epiphany. In 1911, and remember that synesthesia that I talked about, right? So he's hearing color, he's hearing, and he can, when he hears music, he sees color. And when he sees color, he hears music. And I want to show, he goes to a concert. And he goes to a concert by Schoenberg, who is in the way that he is an abstract painter, or will become, showing this kind of music. And I'm gonna play two of the movements. You'll see that in the way of music, it's kind of abstract. Okay, so get ready. I'm playing two movements. I'm probably going to play 30 seconds of each, and then we'll talk again. Come on. First movement, and then the third movement. I'm going to play the third movement. I just didn't want to take too much time. Come on. Any comments?
I found that music very dark and sinister, like something.
Oh, maybe. Uh-huh.
That's how I heard it.
Anybody else? You can't sing to it, right? There's no tune there. So this was really, and I should have played you more. I should have played you the second movement. It goes through different things. I just didn't want to take too much time. But I think you're right, Tracy. I think for a lot of it, it does sound like that. But for Kandinsky, he was just floored by this. It changes him totally. And he changes his whole artistic theory. He actually, starting then, he started a lifelong friendship and wrote to Schoenberg. Schoenberg, they didn't live, I don't think they lived in the same city, but they were pen pals for a long time and influenced each other's work. So in the way that he becomes more abstract, Schoenberg became more abstract to music. I'd like somebody, after he heard that, he went home and he painted this painting, which he called Impression 3. It's not supposed to be a picture of what the concert was, but it's his overall impression of the performance. So can anybody tell me what they see in this painting? Do you see anything at all, or does it look very abstract? Does he think it represents anything special at all? You can hear me, right? I just want to make sure. Hello?
Yes.
Okay.
We all hear you. I'm waiting to see. Maybe someone else has. Anyone have any thoughts? Just unmute yourself.
There's also a raise your hand feature if you're having trouble unmute. If you can find that, I'll unmute for you.
Raise your hand if you want Sean to unmute you.
Well, I'll give you a little hint.
Okay, so
Ruth, hold on. Oh, great, great, good.
To unmute her. She's talking.
There we go.
Sorry.
No, you're okay, Ruth. Oh, did we have the wrong one?
I don't hear her. Ruth Fraester.
Yep. There's a delay sometimes when another person does it.
Hi, Ruth.
Hi, there we go.
Okay. For some reason, I see a piano.
The
top of a piano, and I kind of see the fingers at it, and then the colors emanating from the music. That's my.
Yep. Give that lady a prize. Hi, Ruth. How you doing?
Beautiful interpretation.
Anybody else? Yeah. So this is the piano. That's right. And the music is kind of that yellow, it's kind of brought up. This is the person playing the piano.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the people listening.
Okay.
You're right, you got it. So it's a very abstract, right? But it's not just blobs anywhere. It's that it still has objects in it. And again, the colors, we assume, are very meaningful to him, or what he felt. Again, it's not a copy, it's his impression of the concert. Let's see here, okay. Thank you for that. And that same year, he writes a book which looks at color on emotions, on human emotions. And he feels that the art that he's doing should express his inner emotions. And if you stand and you look at a painting, whether it's realistic or abstract, it should bring emotions to the surface for the viewer. So I'm going to show you a few of his paintings that he does after this point. And they've changed a lot. It changes a lot at this point. And so this is Rowing. Again, if anybody wants to say anything, please do. I'm going to be quiet for a few seconds so you can look at the painting. So we think this is, you know what, I'm going to use this pointer down here. So this could be the boat and the oars and the people, right? So these are not haphazard. He's thinking of color. And again, cannons. We can see people here. We can see the cannons, some buildings up here. So we're still having some objects in the paintings at this point. Color is very important to him. I put this in because you see this a lot these days. When kids study him, they often will do an art project like this. This is actually part of a larger piece that he did, which he was experimenting with color. So he was looking at the same color when it was next to different colors to see what kind of effect it would have, that you would have a different kind of impression of a color based on what was next to it, the whole composition. And you can even see that yourself as you look through and you look for the same color, it gives you a different sense. So this is kind of practice. He did this painting in 1916, Moscow Red Square. Moscow was one of his favorite cities. And he is showing us kind of a move. Again, it's not totally abstract. He's showing us a movement with the shapes of the buildings. We can see people, we can see buildings, we can see birds. Any comment? So he wrote, he loved the time when the sun goes down and melts all of Moscow down to a single spot that, like a mad tuba, starts all of the heart and all of the soul vibrating. And he said, this hour of sunset is the final chord of a symphony that takes every color to the zenith of life that, like the fortissimo of a great orchestra, is both compelled and allowed by Moscow to ring out. So he's really evoking in his own mind sound as well, right? Talks about the tuba and the orchestra and a symphony. It's a very active kind of painting. So I'm going to play another piece here. Let's make sure I get the right one.
So what do you do when your computer crashes and all those memories you've been storing for years are wiped out?
I said that.
This is what
I don't know what happened. Sorry, give me a minute and I'll get this correct. I'm awfully sorry. Here we go.
Part of the process to print. Kandinsky also later painted with oil paints and intense colors. He believed that color was more than just an adjective. It was an object with its own meaning, depth, and purpose. It's even believed that he had synesthesia, which allowed him to see colors when he listened to music. Kandinsky listened to music before or while he painted, and titled many of his works with musical titles, like composition. He once described his unusual sensibility while he was watching an opera performance in Moscow. I saw all my colors in spirit before my eyes. Wild, almost crazy lines were sketched in front of me. In 1921, after spending 7 years in Russia, Kandinsky was ready to try something new. He left Russia once again to live in Germany. There, he taught at the Bauhaus Art School and would develop a new, more minimal way of making art. His work became more geometric in design, and shapes as well as colors began to take on symbolic meaning. In On White 2, Kandinsky listened to music while he was painting. For Kandinsky, white represented the endless possibilities available in life. In black, its non-existence and death. Black slices through the white in the painting, much like death can interrupt opportunities in life. But what else was going on at the
Okay. So he remains at the Bauhaus, and he publishes this book, Point in Line to Plane, while he's there. And this book is about his new approach about teaching. So we know all about color, but now he's really starting to look at form and lines and points as well. So he's going further in his analysis. And form is starting to structure the painting in a dynamic balance that pulses through the canvas. And we start to see those more geometric kind of forms in his painting. So he's moved on again. So this is, again, composition aid. It sounds like it might be music, but he has, he's thinking more here, clearly, about non-objective art. The significance of shapes, and he has triangles here and circles, and there's a checkerboard there. But again, he's also thinking about color. And notice that some of the colors are pretty subtle, or you'll look at a certain area and you'll see that, you know, it's darker here and lighter here. We're not talking about just, you know, lopping down some paint. He does use lots of different kinds of medium too. He uses paint, he uses some printing, although those are earlier in his career. Watercolor, oil, he does a lot of different kinds of things. So this one, he did in 1925. I'm gonna, again, give you a minute to look at it. And if you wanna say something, feel free. I wanted to show this because it's kind of got two sides, and to me evokes different kinds of emotions based on the parts of the painting. So he's looking at squares, circles, and triangles, and abstract shapes, you know, so there's both organic and inorganic, like, you know, squares and triangles, but he's got these curvy lines too that don't really represent any known. They're more organic in terms of their shapes, as opposed to a square or a triangle. And there are curved lines and straight lines, and they go through the colors. So for the person viewing the piece, you can actually divide this thing in half, almost, and see how the left side has rectangles and squares and straight lines and yellows. And the right side has darker colors and, you know, different kinds of shapes. And so the question is, we know that they're sort of meant to evoke, we think, different kinds of emotions based on the left versus the right part of the painting. Here's three sounds. And this clearly, I mean, calls it three sounds. How much more obvious can you get, right? And we, again, his synesthesia is coming in. Circles and triangles, and the forms show different movement, and you kind of, your eye goes around to different areas. By the way, I wanted to mention that at one point he compared color with the sound of musical instruments, and he said, I don't think he stuck to it very specifically, but he mentioned that lemon yellow was a high-pitched trumpet sound, and that light blue is a flute, blue is a violin, lots of blue in here, dark blue is a double bass, an orange an English horn, violet was an oboe, and green was a violin, and white, he said, was a pause. So this does look, he calls it soft pressure. This does look softer to me. I included this painting in here. We're kind of stepping back in time, but the reason I wanted to include it is because he called it To an Unknown Voice, and a woman by the name of Nina Andreevskaya spoke to him on the phone. She was a stranger, and he became mesmerized with her voice. I can't remember why she called. I think she was looking for somebody else. I don't remember, but she spoke to him for a while. And when he got off the phone, he did this painting, and a year later, they were married. This I'm including, you might have seen this decisive pink. This whole thing is not a painting, just this part is his painting. But someone has chosen to kind of deconstruct what is actually in his painting. I thought it was kind of interesting. What the colors are, all the colors that are in the painting, and all the shapes that are in the painting. And I notice he has triangles, but there are different kinds of triangles, so it's not, you know, some are very thin, some are broader, that kind of thing. So this is his, I wanted to include this, lend your ears to music, open your eyes to painting, and stop thinking. And what we're gonna do now is have our art project. I wanna tell you, by the way, it's really hard for me to do this without like seeing everybody's face, and people can't just raise their hand and say this, that, and the other, but I really appreciate you all being here. The art project is really simple. It's just for your enjoyment, and I'm gonna play Wagner's opera in the background so that you have a sense of what he was doing. I am going to, now how do I show myself and my painting here? How do I show, I do speaker view, or you do speaker view, right?
You would basically just do it as you are and then tilt your camera down so that we can see the sheet of paper. I'm happy to help. Yeah, we can see the sheet of paper now. That's wonderful.
So all I'm doing, I'm gonna play Wagner's opera in the background. And all you can take a white piece of paper, small, big, it doesn't matter. And I took a few things that were round, I took some things that were flat, and you can use colored pencils, you can use crayons, you can use markers, you might want to do a sketch first with the pencil.
What are you playing in the background?
What
are you playing in the background?
The Lohengrin opera. I haven't put it on yet. I'll put it on when I finish speaking.
But is it Wagner?
Wagner, yeah.
Why Wagner?
And that was because that was when he had his first, in 1911, he had this epiphany when he heard that music and he decided he wanted to do art. That was his, when he heard the music, it impressed him so. So that's why I'm playing that. That's why I'm choosing.
Wagner is controversial.
You're right. You're right.
Yeah, Michelle, maybe just announce that you're playing it because of the artist, but Wagner is controversial. Maybe
yes.
Maybe not everybody knows that. So
yeah. So what Wagner was not very good to the Jews in his later years. And this was 1911, and this was so well before the Nazis. By the way, I should mention that Kandinsky was, they closed down the Bauhaus, that school that he was teaching in, when the Nazis came in, and they closed down that school and called it degenerate art, and he had to move back. He moved back to Russia at that point. So he actually, his art was suffered because of the Nazis, very much so. So he wasn't Jewish, but he did quote unquote degenerate art. So I'm just gonna, and what you might wanna do, I noticed I have my table here has lines. But Lohengrin was the opera that he was so taken with that it changed his whole trajectory. He was teaching law at that point, and he decided, so I'm just kind of, and then I may use some, I think I may use colored pencils and crayon. You can use a mixture. Okay. So are there any other questions? I'm going to start the music. And tell me if you can hear it. I hope you can. Hang on. Let's see. Just give me an up if you can hear it. Can you hear the music?
It's a little faint, but we can hear it, no problem.
Oh, I can make it louder easily. Hang on. Better?
No.
No? Huh. Hang on, now I just turned it off. Just a second. How's that?
It's a little better. You can hear it. It's not a problem.
Well, you know what I can do? I can share my screen instead.
Sure.
If I do that, then you'll hear it, I think. Should I do that?
Sure. Yeah, yeah.
Let's see here. Then it'll probably be too loud. Let me turn it down before I do that. Sorry. Better?
Yeah.
That's what it is. It has to be a shared screen. So I'll just put this castle up there. And we can do a grid this way. How's that? That works, right?
Yeah.
John, I'd like to see your drawing.
No, you don't.
Anybody want to show their work? I'm going to ask Wenda and Shlomit, if you would like, I could play some of, and the other person who's, if you would like, I can play some of Schoenberg, that very dissonant, and you can do something different to that. It's up to you. If you would like to keep on this, do this. Do you want to continue with this music? I can't hear you. Sean, can you unmute everybody? Sean?
Yep.
Unmute everybody?
Yep.
Remember that really dissonant sound? This I thought was calmer, so that's why I opted for this. Shall we keep with this music?
Maybe switch it to something else, give them a taste of something else.
Is that okay? Will that ruin their work?
Is that okay, everybody?
Or do you want...
I think it'll be okay. Thank you.
This is the second movement. Oops. Where is it? Keep it going though, okay?
Sure.
And this is Schoenberg. Thank you.
Anybody finish their drawings?
As people get off, I'm going to keep the music going, but I just wanted to say thank you very much for coming. It was really fun to tell you about Kandinsky.
Thank you, Michelle. As always, we love your depth and your explanations and all the research that goes into all of this. So thank you so much.
To me, it's really interesting how they progress, how they change. And, Kandinsky changed throughout his life.
And you mentioned that last time with Mondrian. You saw how he also morphed.
Yeah, so the evolution is really.
Yeah.
But Shlomit is right. Wagner was a terrible anti-Semite. He did have Jewish, he liked his music, though. I mean, it was difficult. And I was just reading about him after you said something, and he was definitely anti-Semitic. But this music had, which we're not on now, by the way, this music was still something that really made a big impact on.
I think I heard in the last couple of years that Wagner, his music was played in Israel.
Yes. I mean, he was a genius when it came to music.
Right.
That's right. It was an article. I think it was in the New York.
I remember hearing that.
Yeah. But they say during his lifetime he made no it was in the New Yorker. He made no he didn't try to hide it, his anti-Semitism. And but he, yes, it was in 2012 and so that's why during the Nazi era he became famous, right? But I'm sure that was a big part of why he was so famous. It says here he also admired Jewish poets and had Jewish patrons and fans. So they're kind of, trying to fit it all together. But, yeah.
He just wanted to be sensitive to that.
No, I appreciate it. Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. Yep. He was born in 1813, evidently. So by the time he just heard that opera, he must have been dead already. Right, because it was 1911 when he heard it. Anyway, here comes the music. Not Bach. Thank you.
Possible to put the screen on Shlomit so we can see, and also on Michelle's?
We'll have to just, Michelle would have to stop screen sharing for the time being, and then if we do gallery view, then everyone will be able to see everyone's. So everyone change your own screen to gallery view if you'd like, and then you can see it both at once.
Oh, okay, okay.
So, what do you use, Shlomi? What were you using? Crayons or pencils or?
This is, oh no, that's someone else.
No, that's you. I see you.
No, it's you. Yeah, yeah.
So were you using crayons or pencils, or what were you using to color?
Hold it higher. Beautiful.
Very nice. And you got different values in the colors, like in some of the areas. I can see where you have it darker in some of the areas and lighter with the same color. Those must be crayons, because that's to me what, yeah?
Markers,
oh wow. Huh. Well, I use crayons.
That's good.
I use crayons and markers.
Crayons and markers. Yeah. Huh. Fun.
It was fun. And I learned a lot, actually. I really know much about.
Ruth, you don't want to show us your piece? Ruth is my cousin, by the way.
Oh, nice. She was on before, but now.
Yeah, I see her name.
Yeah.
Well,
Well, this was wonderful, Michelle. Thank you.
Good. So I'm glad
we did it. It went flawlessly and
yeah, good.
And I love, like you said, seeing the evolution.
Right.
Different, and also what went into his thinking, you know, he said, yeah, beautiful, good, so thank you.
All right, well, everyone stay well, okay?
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Shlomit, do you have, are you on my email? Do you get my emails?
Yeah, talking to me?
Yes. Did you see the email from the temple, or do you get my emails?
I need your email. I need it.
Well, if you give me your email, then when I have programs, I'll send it to you.
Okay, so I send you an email, okay?
So do you want to type in your email on the chat, or do you want to tell me it?
I'm sorry?
Do you want to tell me your email, and I'll write it down?
Oh, sure.
Okay.
B-O-R-B-A-L-A, Borbala, 38@gmail.com. So it's B-O-R-B-A-L-A.
I'm not, okay. B as in boy.
Yes.
O as in orange.
Correct.
R is in rabbit.
Correct.
Another B. B is in boy.
Yes.
A is in apple.
Apple, correct. Yes.
I is in igloo.
L and apple.
L.
Oh, A. L. L is in lollipop.
Correct. Borbala. Borbala.
Oh, and then A is in apple.
Correct.
Okay, so B-O-R-B-A-L-A. 38@gmail.
Correct. Thank you.
But you saw the email from the temple. Is that how you got on?
My friend told me about it.
Oh, okay.
Sean, so thank you, you for all your help too.
Oh, no problem.
I'm glad it went well this time.
Yes.
Nice meeting you, Shlomit.
Yeah, Shlomit, nice to meet you.